I love that song. I feel like if I had a song like that, if somebody wrote a song like that about me, it would be, "He's an above average father. It's who he is." You know, I mean, if God is good, then what does that make me? Jeesh. I'm not quite as prolific as any yet. I've got 3 boys, and they're cute as can be now. Our kids don't start out cute, but they get cute. And I don't know, we're made in the image and likeness of God, and sometimes I wonder if they look like me. Do my kids look like me? I don't, it's kind of hard to tell. I don't know if you could imagine them with beards. Maybe that would help. Yeah, I see it. I don't know about you. I see it. Kids are crazy. We had a fundraiser at church one time for the Pro-Life Pregnancy Center, and they were handing out bottles, like baby bottles, with a little note inside, and you were supposed to take these home and put change in the bottle and collect change and bring it back to the church, and they would donate it to the Pro-Life Pregnancy Center. I thought this would be a great way to teach the kids about donating. I could have them do different projects and things that they could earn money that they could then put in the bottle, you know? And so we got one for each of the boys, and I'm back in the back of church talking to a friend of mine after Mass, and the middle son, Frank, walks up to me, and he says, "Hey, Dad," and he's drinking water out of this baby bottle. He's 4 years old. He has not touched a bottle in 3 years, and he's just drinking water. I said, "Frank, where did you get that water?" You're getting ahead of me here. He said, just around the corner. There's the little faucet of the water. Yeah. I was like, "Frank, that's holy water." And it was at that point I realized, we need to do a tour of the church. I need to tell you about these things. And I was like, "That's holy water, Frank." He said, "I was thirsty." When you're thirsty, you just want water. You know, I had a friend who talked me into running a marathon, which that should be a sign that it's not a good friend. If you have a friend that's trying to talk you into running a marathon, you need to find new friends. Friends don't convince friends to run marathons. It's not natural. This isn't something that we do as humans. So I was like, "No way." And he's like, "Oh, we should do it. It'll be fun. We'll do it together. It'll be a way we can get in shape and everything." I said, "Okay." I'm pretty easy to convince things. He wasn't that good of shape. I thought, well, if Mike can do it, then I could do it. You know, like, at least I'll be able to keep up with Mike. And so we start training. By the time he tells me about it, he's been training for months. You know, I've got like a couple months to train for this marathon, and I'm running and running. It's ridiculous how much you have to run. He gets injured. Another guy that he convinced to run with us, my buddy Dan from Popple, he gets injured. So then it turns out it's just me running this marathon. I didn't want to run it in the first place. I never registered. So I was like, "Okay, never mind." He's like, "You can use my registration." All right. I've been training. I might as well do it so I can say I did it. I'm somebody that will follow through. If I say that I'm going to do something, I'm going to do it. Like, even if it's stupid, which marathons are. So we run the Chicago Marathon, me and nobody that I know, but lots of other people. And it turns out to be the hottest Chicago Marathon in history. And people are passing out from dehydration. They literally ran out of water. Talk about you had one job. They ran out of water. People are running hoses out from their house to fill up cups, you know. And I remember I was running, and a guy in front of me starts slowing down as I catch up to him, and he just drops, and I catch him. It was ridiculous. They were making announcements like, we're no longer keeping time. You can stop running. Get in the bus. We'll take you back. And I'm like, what? Other people were like, are we doing this? We made it this far, you know? I don't want to get on a bus now. But I was so thirsty. I wanted to drink a bottle of holy water. No, it was like, I felt like I was drinking water for days trying to catch up. Because when you are thirsty, there's nothing that you want other than water. It's not like coffee is going to satisfy your thirst. Or Pepsi or Mountain Dew or anything. In fact, I had a friend, we used to do these summer camps, and there was a guy that was on team with us for the summer camp, and he was just not getting a lot of sleep, which just what happens. And he's drinking coffee and energy drinks like all day instead of drinking water in the summer. And he's supposed to give a talk that night in front of 300 people. And he just passes out from dehydration. They had to take him to the hospital. Because he was thirsty for water, and instead he's drinking coffee and energy drinks. And we've been talking this weekend about our thirst for God, and that nothing can quench that thirst, no matter how hard we try with the things of this world. Like Jimmy was saying yesterday, it's always going to leave us empty. The crazy thing is that while we are thirsting for God, God thirsts for us. Blows my mind. The God of the universe, the all-powerful, all-knowing, all-loving, he has everything. He does not need you. He thirsts for you. If my wife needed me, well, what kind of a relationship is that? Like, if we had to get married because of some, like, for her entry into the country or for, like, her survival or for my survival, if we were actually dependent on each other, that doesn't mean as much as, I don't need you, but I want to spend the rest of my life with you. God doesn't need us. We don't add anything to God. If we could add something to God, then he wouldn't be God. Like, he is everything. He's created us. But he wants us to be with him. The God who created us out of love, in the beginning, God created. First five words of the Bible. God, who is love, creates. He created us because he just loves so much. It's just like, it was good. And then he's like, wait a minute. They're messing up. We're not going to be able to spend eternity together. I got to fix it. Adam, can you come here for a second? Just jump up here. All right. One of, if not the most popular Bible verse is John 3:16. You see it at sporting events, on billboards, on little Keith Urban songs. Thank you. I'm glad I brought you up here. Tell me, what is John 3:16?
For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that everyone who believes in him might not perish but have eternal life.
Let's give it. Wait, stay here. All right. So God loves us so much that he will give his only son so that we can be with him. I love you, Adam. I love you too. I just made that awkward. I want you to get to heaven. I seriously do. After my wife and my kids, you and everybody else in the world is next on my list. You're in that tied for third place. But I cannot say, for I so love Adam that I would give one of my sons so that if you believe in God, you could have eternal life. Call me a bad Christian, but I can't say that. There's no way. Okay. If that's the case, then Adam doesn't get into heaven. Sorry. All right. Give it up for Adam. I wouldn't do it. Maybe I should. Maybe I should be willing to, but I can't imagine that. But Jesus said, there's no greater love than somebody who would lay down his life for a friend. And Jesus exemplifies this perfectly. The God who is love demonstrates what there is no love greater. He lays down his life for us. And that analogy works a little better for me. I can't imagine letting one of my children die for you. But God and Jesus are the same God. God the Father and Jesus the Son, they're both God. So it's God sacrificing himself for his son, for his daughter. And that's an analogy I can understand. My youngest son, Xavier, who is in that picture, like our kids are born kind of ugly. I worked with this woman, she just had a baby, and it's the cutest, chubbiest baby. I was like, that's a perfect baby. My kids, they look like aliens or reptiles when they come out. Like, that's not cute, but they get cute. But anyway, Xavier was born healthy, odd looking, but healthy. And he's just like kind of growing in, getting his personality, being happy, smiling, like, oh, now this is fun. I like this. And about 3 months in, he starts to get a little sick, and we start getting worried. It gets worse and worse. We take him to the doctor. They don't know what's up. Take him to a specialist. They can't figure it out. He keeps getting sicker, and eventually we start doing all of these tests, all of these x-rays. They're injecting barium into, making him swallow barium so they can do these x-ray videos and track what's going on. And they find out that the muscle above his stomach that keeps food in the stomach is not really working. And so it's not keeping the contents of his stomach. So he's just constantly got stomach contents going up and down his esophagus, sometimes coming out. All of the stomach acid, all this is just tearing up his esophagus. And we had no idea, but this probably been happening for quite a while and nobody could figure it out. So they go in to do a surgery in which they sew that up, and then you put a little peg tube in the side, a little access port where you can administer feeds directly into the stomach. And since it's sewed up, he can't even burp. Nothing can come out, so you even burp him out of this little tube. Now, I say this, and it's an uncommon procedure, but it's not so uncommon that there's a chance that somebody in this room has had that surgery. There's a very good chance that there's a number of you that know somebody that has. But with our little baby, we had a couple different issues come up. Because we were pumping, the little machine pumps the milk into the stomach. And we think everything's going well. They're going to be sending us home soon with the pump. This is how we'll be feeding him for a while. And what we didn't realize, he starts getting sick again, and nobody knows what it is. He's spiking fevers, he's really uncomfortable. They start doing some x-rays, and they found out that the tube had come out from the stomach, but was still in there. So we didn't notice that it came out, but instead of administering this milk into his stomach, it was injecting it into his body outside of the stomach. So he wasn't getting the nutrition that he was supposed to get, and instead, all of his organs were getting flooded with milk, which isn't good. So they cut him open, take out organs, rinse him out, put him back together, sew him back up. Crazy medical technology, right? And then it gets infected because it's pretty much impossible to get all of that out the first time. So then he has to go back for another surgery. He is so malnourished because he hasn't been getting feeds. And then before he goes into surgery, you have to starve him. It's just been one thing after another. He's this poor little innocent 3-month-old baby, had been in the hospital for a month, has to go in for this surgery, and we're not sure if he's going to make it. We're not sure if he's going to be able to survive, if he has the energy to do it. They're going to cut him open again, rinse him out again, sew everything up, put the button back in. And they brought him back from the surgery, and I remember looking at him and seeing this little kid in so much pain and so weak he couldn't even express the pain. And I remember looking at him just wishing that I could trade places with him. Wishing that if I could have taken on 10 times the pain, or 100 times the pain, or done anything, I would have traded in places in a second. But I couldn't. It wasn't an option. They don't say, do you want to trade places with your son? I couldn't do it. I just had to watch him. And it's about a year now, he's doing healthy. I kind of want to put a little close on that. But I get it. The God of the universe is our perfect father. And my love for my son pales in comparison to God's love for you. It's not even close. So even though I don't like it, I don't like the idea of the crucifixion, I don't like that Jesus had to take my place, I get it. I get why God would do that. See, God is infinitely merciful, but that doesn't contradict his infinite justice. And so why he will forgive you for anything, if you ask for forgiveness, there's still a price for sinning against an infinite God. A price that, quite frankly, we can't pay. If I break Joe's guitar, he can forgive me, but there's still a broken guitar that needs fixed or replaced. And somebody needs to pay for that, whether it be me or Joe, the conference, whatever. And so God thirsts for us so much that he would pay the ultimate sacrifice that would end all sacrifices. The scripture for this weekend is from Romans 5:8. And it says, but God proves his love for us in that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. The verse right before that says, indeed, only with difficulty does one die for a just person. Though perhaps for a good person, one might even find courage to die. There's no greater love than to lay down your life for a friend. Yeah, maybe with difficulty you could do that. Maybe you could lay down your life for a good person. But Paul says, God proves his love for us in that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. He proved it. You want proof that God loves you? Look at the cross. It started with humiliation. Them mocking him, putting him on this trial, turning him in. This Jesus, he was innocent. And he had to deal with all of this ridicule. He didn't do anything wrong. And they're making fun of him and mocking him. And to be honest, that's probably the worst thing we'll have to endure for living out our faith. There are places in the world where there's religious persecution, where you could be tortured or killed for your faith, but not here. The most we'll probably ever have to endure is somebody making fun of us or not understanding. Then they scourge him, which they're whipping him, but not just with a whip, but a whip that has these tassels. And on the end of the tassels are pieces of bone and fish hooks. And they're ripping into his skin. The Romans were very good at killing people. Like, if there was one thing that the Romans did well, it was torture and kill people. They knew how many times you could whip somebody with one of these torture devices and how much they could bleed out before they would die and they would stop. So you had to endure the maximum amount of pain and suffering and drag it out for as long as possible. They take a crown of thorns, which, you know, I might picture like a rose bush or something with these little thorns, but in reality, it were these long thorns, hard like spikes that they would have put on his head and beat it down with a stick, jabbing into his head. And then they make him carry his cross up the hill, out of the city, up the hill. Not to put him up on display, but because the crucifixion was so gruesome that they couldn't do it in town, that they had to go off and do it. They take nails, put it up against his skin, and pound them in with hammers, and hang him on a cross where he's basically suffocating in excruciating pain. And he says, I thirst. And he's not talking about just water, but that he thirsts for you. Mother Teresa loved this phrase, I thirst. I've been to, when I was in Honduras, we volunteered a lot with the Sisters of Charity, and you go into one of their chapels, they're very simple. There's not a whole lot of decoration or anything. There's a crucifix, and right beside it is I thirst, real big. And she would have her sisters meditate on this concept a lot. And she would have them put their name in and then say, I thirst.